Welcome to Almost Here, Round the Corner Future Technology Podcast with Richard Jacobs. Future technologies poised to transform our lives for better or worse are the focus of this podcast. Almost Here means these technologies are now here and starting to be used, or just around the corner, from Bitcoin to artificial intelligence, 3D printing, blockchain, virtual reality, and more.
Hello, this is Richard Jacobs with the Future Tech and Future Tech Health podcast. And my guest is Rachel Burke. She's the founder of Aussie Keto Queen. The website itself is AussieKetoQueen.com. So Rachel, thanks for coming.
Hi, Richard. Thanks for having me on.
Yeah. So what's the, I said this many times, but in health, I know that people are usually into health related stuff because either a personal experience or someone they know, you know, had health issues. So, you know, if you don't mind, like, what's your background and what led you to work in the keto world?
Yeah, sure. So like a lot of people that discover the ketogenic diet, it starts with weight loss. You know, a lot of people have sort of tried just about every weight loss technique that's out there. But sort of about 4 or 5 years ago, I'd been trying a few different diets. I was sort of in my mid-20s and I'd, you know, tried paleo and a few different things like that. And I was never, you know, massively overweight, but definitely carrying around more than I should. And, you know, I was pretty conscious of that being a mid-20-year-old female. So I sort of stumbled across the ketogenic diet by accident, by actually Googling how can I eat cheese on paleo. So that's sort of how I ended up on the ketogenic diet. And I just, the nature of my brain is that when I find something like that that piques my interest, I just spend, you know, all my time researching. So, yeah, sort of just spent hours and hours and hours reading and listening to every podcast and book and website that was out there. But this was, you know, 4 or 5 years ago when it wasn't sort of really mainstream. So there wasn't a lot of information out there. There was only a small handful of books and pretty limited websites with recipes and meal plans as well. So you sort of had to dig quite deep to really get, you know, some clear information on it. So from there, I started doing it and, you know, lost weight really, really quickly. Ended up losing about 20 kilos, which for you guys, I think is close to 50 pounds, 45, 50 pounds. And that was in about 9 months, which just absolutely shocked me. Like, I didn't think it was possible. I had to sort of replace my whole wardrobe because none of my clothes fit me in such a short amount of time. Then I've been able to maintain it since then. So it's sort of, it confirmed for me that it, you know, it is a really healthy way to eat. And I was seeing a naturopath and a doctor at the same time and always getting everything checked out and my blood's checked and all of my health indicators were just improving, you know, month on month. So I was just like, okay, this is, I'm onto a winner here. Like, more people need to know about it. So from there, I've always loved cooking and, you know, delicious food and fine dining. And I didn't sort of want to restrict that and, you know, make this a short-term diet in inverted commas. I wanted to make it a real lifestyle change. So I sort of started sharing a few recipes online, built this little, you know, shonky website to share some recipes out there, and some, you know, interesting things I discovered and articles and tips and that sort of thing. And it's just grown and grown over the last few years, to the point where, you know, I've got tens of thousands of people on there most days sort of looking at my recipes and asking questions. It's become much more than a hobby. I'm now sort of thinking whether it could be a full-time job to, you know, be helping people through the process. So it's been, definitely great. Not the direction I saw my life going in a few years ago.
Well, so you've worked with a lot of people, I'm sure, you know, thousands. So what are you noticing is, you know, the easy stuff no one really talks about because it's the easy stuff. So, you know, let's talk about the hard stuff. What do you see is uniquely difficult for people about the keto diet and how are you meeting that need?
Yeah, I think a lot of it is mindset. I see people quite often join, you know, my Facebook group or something like that and say, you know, I haven't lost weight and I've been on this for a week or 2 weeks, or, you know, this isn't going to be sustainable. How can you not eat pasta and bread and rice? And I think, honestly, like, that is in your head. Nobody says we have to eat bread and pasta and rice. So tackling it more from a mindset point of view has been my approach, rather than just telling people you have to eat this and there's no leeway, because I don't think that's that's not a true lifestyle change. You can't sustain that if you just feel like you're constantly deprived. So, yeah, I think changing the mindset is probably the most difficult thing for people to do. And you've got to be ready to change your mindset. It doesn't happen overnight. So it takes, you know, a lot of reading and a lot of research about what is best for your body and really feeling how amazing you can feel on the ketogenic diet, I think is, you know, a crucial piece of that puzzle.
Yeah, I found that it makes it easy if you have a gun to the head reason, you know, like cancer or epilepsy or diabetes or, you know, some other unfortunate, you know, heart attack, that kind of stuff. You know, no one should wait for that, obviously, but, you know, when something like that happens to you, it makes it a lot easier to do something like this because it's like a gun to your head.
I saw a friend whose husband unfortunately had a stroke probably about 2 years ago. And the stroke side of it, he recovered quite well, but they said to him, you know, unless you lose some weight very rapidly, you'll be at major risk again of having another stroke. So he went on the ketogenic diet and, you know, he is almost religious about it, how strict he is. He won't even have, you know, one bite of bread. He's just like, nope, not worth it. You know, this nearly killed me eating all those burgers and fries over the last 40 years. I'm not going to do it again. So I think, yeah, having that gun to the head is a good thing, but I don't think we should let it get that far either, because then there's, you know, a lot of the damage is done.
So what percentage of the people that you work with have gun to the head reasons and what percentage don't? And, you know, do you have to work with them differently or do you have to do much at all with the, you know, the gun to the head people, or they just do it themselves? Like what have you observed?
Yeah, I think you're right. The kind of people do often find it themselves. And I'm seeing more and more people saying, my doctor has put me onto this. I just need some recipes. So, you know, it's a doctor ordered diet. The doctor doesn't want to put them on more medication. They want them just to follow some recipes. And when you've got that motivation, I think you've got a real reason to say no to the sweets and all that sort of thing. Whereas, yeah, I'd say it's probably 50-50 between people who've discovered it because of, you know, they've got some metabolic issue that their doctor's put them onto the ketogenic diet. And 50% are, you know, I either want to lose some weight, I want to get healthier, I've heard you can have great energy, those sorts of more, not just aesthetic, but that it tends to focus more on the aesthetic reasons to do the diet.
So you said that you know doctors that put their patients on the keto diet?
Yeah, absolutely. I don't know if this is an Australian phenomenon, but I'm seeing it more and more.
I think so. I think so because I've never heard that here, and that's very sad.
Really?
But
absolutely.
Like functional doctors maybe, but it's rare.
Yeah, so the first one I heard was probably about 2 or 3 years ago, and I just started seeing a few trickle people come into the Facebook group saying, you know, my doctor's recommended I look at low carb, you know, because I'm diabetic or because I need to get my blood pressure down or my cholesterol's too high. And I thought, oh, wow, this is new. Like, this is a pretty amazing change. And then I sort of had some, you know, direct anecdotal experience with my grandmother who's in her early 70s and type 2 diabetic. And her specialist said she absolutely must go on the ketogenic diet so she's no longer relying on insulin shots. And, you know, she did, and she lost quite a lot of weight and has successfully gone off her insulin shots. So, you know, I think that was all thanks to her doctor that recommended she do that.
Yeah, wow. Well, that's good to know that in Australia it's definitely more of a trend than here. Here, the doctor that I went to was an endocrinologist, and they would deal with, you know, diabetes patients. And it's sad. Mm-hmm. In the office, you know, they have like this, you know, all these like snack bars that are artificially sweetened and tons of carbs. And they're telling all their patients, here, take insulin and, you know, have these like snack bars, and that's going to help you. And I know it's not at all. It's terrible. So I'm glad to see
that
you're seeing doctors that know what they're doing.
Yeah. That's fair. And it's by no means all of them. And we still suffer from, you know, a lot of the doctors who are suggesting a ketogenic diet. They are, you know, getting attacked by the medical board. So they've got to be willing to take on that fight if they really believe in it. But so it's, you know, it's by no means the norm. But I think it's getting there, which is good. And I was even in a naturopath a couple of weeks ago. I sort of do a food intolerance test just to see, if, you know, how my gut flora was going and all that sort of thing. And cool. I noticed that they were promoting the ketogenic diet as a naturopath's office. And she said for weight loss, and for, you know, getting your metabolism back on track. She said it's the number one thing they recommend now. And I'm like, wow, how far have we come in the last few years? Because they used to be all about, you know, brown rice and low fat. So that's totally flipped on its head, you know, in a short amount of time, which is really exciting.
Well, what have you noticed culturally just around town and with friends? And, you know, is Australia any different from the US? Is everyone there? Is the common ethos to low fat and, you know, tons of carbs and sugars there? Or what's it like?
Yeah, it's definitely changing. I came to the States for about a month, getting close to 2 years ago. And gosh, I struggled to eat keto. You know, it was pretty tough over there. In, you know, America's defense, I was on my honeymoon and I was in, you know, major city centers, so I wasn't trying that hard either. But I think in Australia, a lot of our food's really focused around fresh and fresh vegetables, and we do have really great fresh produce. So, you know, the large majority of restaurant meals come with, you know, a side salad, or you can easily get, you know, some broccoli or something on the side of almost every dish. And it's just, I think we've got a lot of cafes and restaurants that are really open to different food sensitivities and different diets anyway. So there's whole restaurants where you can walk in and say, look, I'm a paleo vegan, but I eat dairy, but I can't have nuts, and they'll have something for you. So I think we're pretty good in that sense. And, you know, I don't get weird looks anymore when I have a burger without a bun. And, you know, they're frequently on burger menus now, a low carb bun, or, you know, a bunless burger, and it's in a big lettuce wrap. So yeah, I think we've definitely got to focus on healthy eating. The one thing that I'm finding is just starting to catch on, and I'm, you know, still getting some strange looks, is when I talk about fasting. So intermittent fasting starting to become a little bit more okay with, you know, friends and family. If I say, oh, no, you know, I never eat breakfast, I never have. You know, I'm happy with a cup of tea, and then, you know, I eat lunch sort of about 2 p.m. And that still gets some pretty weird looks, like, why are you not having breakfast? What's wrong? You know, is this healthy? That sort of thing. And, you know, if I started to talk about extended fasting, people get pretty worried that, you know, there's something wrong with my head. So to talk about, you know, not eating for a few days is pretty scary for a lot of people. But I think within a couple of years that will change, just as much as, you know, the ketogenic diet has changed the way we all think about food.
Well, what's in the world of intermittent fasting, what kind of protocol do you follow, and what have you found works well enough, like a 16:8 or a 23.5.5, or what do you do?
Yeah, I've done the 1 meal a day, you know, quite a bit in the past, but mostly just when it sort of fits my lifestyle. I'm all about doing what feels right for you. And, you know, if you get to 1 p.m. and you haven't eaten and you're absolutely starving, you know, genuinely hungry, not just, oh, this is my lunchtime and I should be eating, if you need to learn to be able to tell the difference between those two things. And once you do, you can start to fall into a pattern of eating when you are genuinely hungry. And that's what I do. I, you know, sort of naturally have fallen into probably more of like an 18:6. So eating from sort of usually about 2 p.m. and then dinner, you know, 7:30, 8 o'clock at night. So got that 6-hour window there. But that's just happened. It's just progressed naturally over time. I'm often, you know, busy in the mornings at work. I can't, you know, stop. I don't really want to stop to eat, and I'm not hungry. And then, you know, I try not to eat too close to bedtime either. So try to avoid any eating after about 8 p.m. So that's great. I think that's happened quite naturally. But I think it's a matter of finding what really works for your body, your lifestyle, your work, you know, your timetable, and just going with that. Yeah.
Well, all right. So let's talk about the recipes, because, you know, from looking at your site, that's what you're big into. So how do you know, are you trying to approximate, you know, standard foods, but ketify them, I guess, for lack of a better word, or are you just following keto principles and making snacks that are just standalone good for you? You know, for instance, like, are you trying to make keto cookies or keto lasagna, or are you just making, like, hey, meat and vegetables and with this special sauce that's just keto on its own?
Yeah, it's funny because I just lean towards the naturally keto foods. So, you know, meat and veggies with, you know, some delicious sauce, that's what I eat for the large majority of my meals. But the keto community loves cake and cookies, so I have had to keto-fy some of those meals and recipes. But percentage-wise, I mean, probably 80% of my recipes are meat and veg or some variation on that, and the 20% are by request cookies and cakes and bars and slices and that sort of thing. So that's not my preference. I don't think we should be eating a lot of that stuff. And I think it still does have an effect on blood sugar and insulin, even when we are using, those keto approved sweeteners. So whenever I do post up a recipe, like I've got a keto caramel slice on there, which is really popular, but it uses a lot of sweetener. It just has to by nature, for the recipe. I'm always making a note that this is a treat that, you have to cut it into 30 small squares and it is very sweet. And once you've had your one square, you need to put it away for like days or give it to a friend or take it to work or something. Like, you should not be having this stuff every single day. And once you're really deep into ketosis and you're, well and truly fat adapted, you don't really need it or want it as much either. I think you lose a bit of your sweet tooth, and you start to taste sweetness in, things that might not have tasted sweet before, like capsicum or bell peppers, as you guys call them. I find those really sweet because, I'm not having sweets all the time.
That's true. There's a few things my wife makes and I'm like, did you put sugar in here? And she's like, no. Like, we had cabbage with, some other stuff, and it was so sweet. It tasted to me like it had a lot of sugar in it. And she's like, I didn't put anything in it. It's just, that's the natural cabbage. So it actually made me suspicious.
Isn't that amazing?
Like, maybe I shouldn't even eat it because it was too sweet. And then when I try stuff that's normally sweetened, it's like, blah, it's horrible. It's so sweet.
Yeah.
You know?
Sickly sweet, and sometimes if you have one, like the caramel slice, I find it really, really sweet. But I think it helps people when they are adjusting or even going through those first phases of is it a diet, is it a lifestyle change, to know there are those backups. So it's someone's birthday or you've got friends coming over, you can still make something nice that everybody will enjoy, without getting any strange looks that you're not allowed to have sugary treats. So I think it adds that element of making it a long-term change.
What about, are people asking you how to ketify stuff? I just made up that term, by the way. But, let's say there are people eat out at restaurants and stuff. What about a guidebook on how to ketify your meals? Maybe you can't fix them 100%, but you can alter them,
You can get pretty close. That's it. I've got a list on my website of in Melbourne, keto-friendly restaurants and cafes. So they're not specifically the whole restaurant is, but it's more that people have found a particular dish or they're, the people are really accommodating to take certain things out. And I encourage everybody to send me an email if they find something, take a photo, send me the name of the restaurant and I'll keep that running. So, that's been going really, really well. I think people love just being able to Google, keto restaurants in Melbourne, and be able to know there's 20 or 25 options up there so they can choose where they're going, and then get their friends to go there so they've got some options up their sleeve. So I think everybody in every city should have a list like this. So, you can never say, oh, I didn't have a choice, I had to eat pasta. There's always options out there.
Okay. So where do you want to take this? Where do you see is the greatest need for your intervention? How do you feel like you're going to be able to help people the most and make money doing it, rightfully so?
Yeah, I'm sort of working through that decision at the moment because I work full-time in a completely unrelated field. But I'm leaving that industry at the end of this year, so about 2 months away. So I'm sort of weighing up how to help the largest number of people at the moment because, I can share recipes and tips. I run a Facebook group and I'm running a 21-day challenge in November as well. That's had a really great response from people. It's sort of a back to basics, really clean keto for 3 weeks, cutting out the sweeteners and alcohol and that sort of thing. So that seems to have gained some really good traction. And I think it struck a nerve with a lot of people because we often start the keto diet and a lot of people started early in the year and now have strayed. So I'm thinking running the challenge has really opened my eyes that people want some group accountability. So there might be something around some group coaching. And I have toyed with the idea of creating sort of a really comprehensive beginner's course that they can jump online, you know, get every answer, every question they've got answered, and get some one-on-one coaching as well. So that's sort of, yeah, I'm working through that decision at the moment, because I'm such a strong believer in this, and I've seen the way it's helped, you know, me and my friends and my family and, you know, thousands of others that send me emails. So now the question is, as you said, how do you, you know, get that to reach out to as many people as possible? So yes, it's not an easy question to answer.
Okay. So one or two more questions. What did you notice when you first started doing the keto lifestyle, you know, eating that way? And what have you noticed over time? You know, what got easier for you? Has anything gotten harder? Mm-hmm. You know, what changes have you noticed? And again, what, you know, for people that are going to go through this or are considering it, or maybe are in the throes of it, you know, week 1, 2, 3, 4, whatever, 6 months out, you know, how can you help them? What have you seen?
Yeah, I think those first few weeks, as much as physically it might be the hardest because you might get the keto flu, mentally I think they're the easiest, because they're the weeks where you are motivated, you've got a reason, you get that really quick weight loss often at the start just from dropping your water weight and inflammation. After that is when the real work starts, where, you know, it might have been 3 weeks or 6 weeks or 8 weeks, and weight loss might be plateauing or it might have stopped completely. And then you think, oh, you know, this isn't even working anymore. So I think that's a really challenging time. And that's when you start to, you know, creep in some sweets and that sort of thing that can derail you pretty quickly. So I definitely found that time a little bit tough. But, you know, I had the motivation of I had a certain amount of weight that I wanted to lose within that year. And, you know, that was my motivation, and I had a really clear goal, so that definitely helped. Longer term, I found probably the biggest challenge I've had is about 12 months ago, I had to go on some medication that caused me to gain weight, and I gained about 10 kilos, so, you know, gained back half of what I'd lost, you know, after sustaining a ketogenic lifestyle for so long. That really threw me for six. That sort of made me go, oh, gee, you know, what is the point? I'm still eating a perfect keto diet. I'm still exercising and, you know, I'm gaining weight. Like how frustrating is this? This isn't fair. And having that sort of mentality about, you know, the fairness of it, I think, didn't do me any favors, because then I thought, well, what's even the point if I'm still gaining weight? So I had to go through a bit of a mental process and a mindset shift myself that ketogenic diet is not about weight, and it's not about losing or maintaining weight. It's about all of the internal health that it creates, and about your energy levels and about all the other benefits from it. And if you gain some weight from some medication, or, you know, from stress or sleep or being pregnant or any of those things, those are okay, because, you know, your health is still at an optimum level. So I think that, yeah, losing that motivation over time can be one of the toughest things.
Okay. Well, very good. So what's the best way for people to join your Facebook group or get in touch, ask questions and find out more?
Yeah, sure. Well, the website, as you said, is AussieKetoQueen.com. And I am running this challenge from the 9th to the 30th of November. So it's starting in just over a week. And you can jump on the website and click 21-day challenge. And that's got links through the Facebook group and, you know, free downloadables of everything we're going to be eating and all that sort of thing. Otherwise, yeah, on the website, you can jump in and check out some recipes and follow me on Facebook and Instagram.
Well, very good. Well, thanks for coming on the podcast, and I really appreciate it.
No, you're welcome. Thanks, Richard, and I'm looking forward to all your other ketogenic guests. It's great to have you focusing so much on the ketogenic diet. It's definitely giving me a lot of inspiration.
Okay. Well, it's changed my life for the better, so I want to help other people. So, yeah, thank you. No problem.
You have been listening to Almost Here, Around the Corner Future Technology Podcast with Richard Jacobs. Subscribe to this podcast, post a review, to discover more future technologies that are poised to transform our lives for better or worse, such as Bitcoin, artificial intelligence, 3D printing, blockchain, virtual reality, and more.